Now, since 1979, the current affairs program 60 Minutes has been a juggernaut in Australian TV news. In fact, many of the morning and afternoon television shows we watch now, even in part the creation of Sky News, have followed on from the success and interest that was captured by 60 Minutes. It created an audience very keen to hear more about the stories that mattered, both here and abroad. And the man behind this trailblazing program is its first executive producer, Gerald Stone, who sadly passed away aged 87 today. Well, tributes have poured in, as you can imagine, after his death, and many have revisited those early years of 60 Minutes and the Sunday show that changed the media landscape. We all remember the first reporting team, Ray Martin, George Negus, and the man I just happen to have in the studio with me right now, Ian Leslie. Ian, thank you very much for coming in. What a sad day, not just for you and the early team, but also for the crews that have followed and worked with and after Gerald Stone was there.
It's a very sad day, Chris. We've been stealing for it now for some time because Gerald wasn't in good shape for quite a while. But yes, it is, because here is a giant in our industry. I think that Gerald Stone changed Australian current affairs more than any other television executive. As you said in your introduction, we're living with his legacy, not just one generation, but with several generations. It's the model that he established, which really set the path for modelling current affairs, public affairs programs, 40 years.
Yeah. He not only had an eye for great stories, and he also had an eye for great storytellers. And so he chose you at the very beginning. What do you remember about the call you got when Gerald says, I've got an idea and I want you to be part of it?
It was somewhere mid-1978, around 7 o'clock. I'll never forget it. I wanted to leave the Nine Network. Current Affair had been taken away. Willis, who was smashing us, I didn't really know where to go. I got this call from Gerald. It was this American voice at the end of the line. And truly, it was like winning the lottery. Not just then, but every one of those 11 years that I was with the program, working with Gerald, I was winning the lottery, because it was just a sheer joy to work with this man. I mean, his skills were multiple. His intellect was enormous. His sense of story, his ethics were unshakable. And his production values, Chris, brought a whole new dimension to broadcasting. We always used to say that when we produced a 60-minute story, it was like a little mini movie.
Yeah.
His attention to detail, to sound, to vision, and to the storytelling was an enormous step forward that we'd seen before. So he has no peer in my book. We loved him dearly then. We love him dearly now. He was just a wonderful human being to work with.
My information from when I was at Nine was that he was very quick to congratulate people who did well, but he was also quick to critique if you missed the story or missed the angle. Let me play something that I think he would have enjoyed, even though you didn't feel comfortable with it.
I think I know the one you're talking about.
Which is the gun to the head of Ian Leslie.
Whiskey demand like this.
Gulp.
Well, that's probably the most played scene in 60 Minutes. Gerald knew the value of a moment, but he didn't overemphasise that. I got no congratulations for that, because I don't think it was right. That happened. It was in Mindanao. That guy was a Aquila, who was the leader of a guerrilla group, and I'd watched him. He used to swagger around his people with a big American Colt on it slung to his side, and I asked him, just what do you do with that? And that was his reply: I shoot my captors, my prisoners, with it. So, yes, 60 Minutes, that certainly moved the program, or helped move the program on. That was in 1981. And while we were right up there, we were whacking the opposition. There were always little lulls, dips and troughs. And those sort of things carried us.
He had his fair share of clashes with Kerry Packer, didn't he? Because Kerry was forking out more for 60 Minutes than most of the other programs.
Look, Gerald Stone was a man of steel. Thank God he had to be tough. And Kerry harangued him for those first two or three years mercilessly. I mean, after that inauspicious start on the 11th of February 1979, 60 Minutes premiere flop, as it was canned, Packer was furious. So he called Gerald in, and Gerald thought he was in for the, you know, the high jump. He was in for the chop. Packer harangued and said he'd seriously let him down. I'm going to pull the show. Gerald stepped out of the office. Packer dismissed him, said, get out of here. Gerald walked out, picked up the courage to walk back into Kerry and said, Kerry, if you fire me or I'll resign, that's OK, but do not can the show. That would be absurd. And Kerry said, OK, get out anyway. And Gerald had won that battle. Mm. But they were many, Chris. Yeah. Sunday nights were Gerald's time to relax over a glass of wine and watch the show with his wife, Irene. But he knew that at the end of the show, every Sunday night for those first 2 years, there would be angry Kerry on the line complaining about a question George had asked, maybe something Jana had said, a silly story that Leslie had done. And on one occasion he said, I demand to see my reporters in my office in Park Street tomorrow morning, have them there. Gerald said, you can't see them. Why not? He said, they're all away somewhere in the world doing their job. Yeah. And Kerry, if you have a problem with them, leave it to me. That's what you're paying me yeah. for. I will handle those.
A man of steel. I just want to play a little bit of a grab.
A man of steel, absolutely. And you know where he got that from? Well, he was born with that, but not much is known, spoken about Gerald Stone's military service. Now, in the mid-50s, it was compulsory for all healthy young American boys to do national training. Mm-hmm. Gerald went to Fort Steele in the artillery section in Oklahoma,
right.
and he graduated as a first lieutenant, and he carried the code of that regiment
yeah.
With him throughout life, and I think that's what steeled Gerald to put up with a monster of a proprietor.
And then,
we have to say that it was Kerry's idea. 60 Minutes
yeah.
was Kerry's idea, and he was a fantastic proprietor in that he protected that property.
Let's end this tribute with Gerald Stone getting an award on behalf of 60 Minutes, the Logies Hall of Fame.
Thank you. Thank you. Good reporters don't cry. So I guess I lost my chance to be a good reporter.
It touched him.
It's the only time I've ever seen Gerald almost speechless, yeah. but that was a very emotional time for him. He'd waited all those years, 40 years, for that kind of recognition. It should have come earlier, and he was overwhelmed. And he was an emotional man, but he had that ability to control his emotions. Mm. But at that time, things just were so wonderful,
yeah.
but they got a little bit too much.
It was fitting. Ian, Leslie, what a great tribute. The passing of Gerald Stone. Thank you very much for your time tonight.
Thank you, Chris.
Ian, Leslie.